All right, YouTube. Once again, it's Kennard Vernon Stewart here for the podcast. We're talking Auburn football. Go ahead and like the video, comment, and subscribe to the channel. And as always, it's great to be an Auburn Tiger, War Eagle. Okay, of course, Auburn has spring football on the horizon, and the basketball team is still relatively competitive. We're going to see what they will do in the tournament that's coming up pretty soon. The SEC tournament is coming up. We'll see. Hell, they might be able to sneak a SEC tournament champion chip with a nice surge down the stretch, but that's yet to be seen. But let's talk about Auburn football for a moment. And this is a conversation that I've actually been dodging here for the last few weeks because I really wanted to make sure that we were objective in our opinions. We want to talk about Bo Nix today. Bo Nix, a five-star recruit out of the state of Alabama, went to Pinson Valley High School, was arguably one of the more productive quarterbacks in Alabama history, winning a state championship there, and ironically played his last football game in high school at Jordan-Hare Stadium, winning the state championship for the state of Alabama, and the following spring, he's competing for a starting position at quarterback at Auburn University. So let me tell you about what this means. At the surface, you talk about a legacy quarterback, his father, Patrick Nix. You can't mention any conversation. You can't mention you can't have a conversation about Auburn football's quarterbacks without Patrick Nix being somewhere in the mix conversation wise, because, you know, Patrick Nix was Auburn's quarterback during some of the most successful tenures in Auburn history on that 1993 undefeated season, which they couldn't compete for the national championship at that time. Because Auburn was on, unfortunately, on probation. They won a lot of games in Auburn fashion. You all know how Auburn wins these big games. I mean, who possibly can win a game with four interceptions returned for a touchdown? Only Auburn can do things like that. So Patrick Nix's name is etched in Auburn's history. So now you have a quarterback, Bo Nix, an heir to his father's throne, so to speak. Now, after competing in the spring, showing his talent, showing his ball skills, beats out Joey Gatewood, and now he's the starting quarterback for the Auburn Tigers in one of the most pivotal seasons in recent history for Auburn. Mind you, having the luck of the draw in having Oregon as your first game. Oregon, Pac-12 hopeful. Guess what? Oregon winds up winning the Pac-12 championship. LSU winds up winning the national championship. Florida competes on a high level this year, beating Auburn down in Ben Hill Griffin Stadium down in the swamp. Having to face Georgia, who has one of the best rosters in college football, constantly upgrading that roster with the hire of Cochran, could upgrade it even more. Then you talk about Alabama, the mainstay, a team that you just about have to have everything go your way and then some to beat. This is all on Bo Nix, true freshman quarterback, was just playing high school football the year before, now having to face all of this. Now, I was a harsh critic of Bo Nix, and I don't know if it was rightfully so or not. I'm starting to believe it was not justifiable, because having to put a quarterback in that position as a true freshman in the SEC. Now, there are some other quarterbacks around the country who were very successful, a lot more successful statistically than Bo Nix. But I asked the question, if that same quarterback, say the true freshman at Arizona State that had a pretty good year, if you throw him in the rigors of the SEC, would he have been as successful? Would he have been able to be the SEC freshman of the year? A lot of folks don't think that Bo Nix deserves it, but on the low, you know, we talk about even the cornerback from LSU, Stingley. Did he deserve it? I think from a, you know, production standpoint, maybe he could state a case. But he had a lot of great players around him that helped to enhance his game. What did Bo Nix have? Bo Nix had a shaky offensive line. Bo Nix did not have the caliber of talent at wide receiver that he needed, in my opinion, to really get the job done on a high level. The running back situation was a little bit unstable. You talk about having Boobie Whitlow, who was a dual threat quarterback at a 2A school in Alabama, as your starting running back for a Power 5 football team, which is very unlikely. Not no disrespect to Booby Whitlow, but I don't think Booby Whitlow is as elite as what Auburn needs to be competitive against a LSU, Georgia, Alabama, Florida, Oregon, etc., at least to take it to the next level. And that's what Auburn is right now. They want to take things to the next level. And Bo Nix is a guy that will definitely have to take his individual game to the next level. Does he have the intangibles? Yes, he runs the ball very well. He has a pretty good arm. He has some ball protection issues in the RPOs. But can Bo Nix fix those little things? And can Chad Morris, the offensive coordinator, has done a great job with developing quarterbacks in the past. Can he develop Bo Nix into having more options with his abilities? And let me explain to you what I'm talking about. We're going to talk about Bo Nix's scrambling for one. Bo Nix as a scrambler tend to scramble to his dominant side, which is his right side. In a lot of cases, his right side took him to the sideline, where the sideline was an extra defender, where wide receivers, if they do break their routes, Bo Nix does not have a passing window to throw to. So it makes it appear that, you know, the conversation is always about whether Cody Burns can develop wide receivers, but the scrambling, broken plays, winds up being either a throwaway or a sack. Yes, Bo Nix was very good at dodging sacks, but a lot of times his scrambling was just non-productive. So what Bo Nix is going to have to concentrate on in spring football is actually scrambling to his non-dominant side. That's where you have more field. That's where you have more opportunities for the receivers to get open. And he can create those Baker Mayfield type plays, or maybe even those Johnny Manziel type plays, to where Auburn's offense can be even more effective. We also talk about the utilization of the tight end. Auburn has done a great job of recruiting tight ends, which gives the indication. I'm not sure. I can't say it. I don't know. But at least gives the indication that Auburn is going to utilize the tight ends a lot more. That will also give Bo Nix some more options. Also, the offensive line from 2019, they were all seniors, but as a collective group, they just weren't really all that good. And they didn't give Bo Nix, I think, the time and the opportunity to make plays, and it got him erratic early in certain plays, and plays broke down, and then they broke all the way down to where there was no solution. I think even with a brand new slate of offensive linemen, in my opinion, it has to be different. I think they have to be more effective than last year. I don't think they can help it. I think they will have a lot more athletic offensive line. Some of the plays that Gus Malzahn is going to call some of the plays. I mean, you're just not going to see a Gus Malzahn just sitting on the sideline, not having anything to do with the schematics of play calling. Bo Nix is the guy that I feel that can make this happen, given the right opportunity and given the right system. One thing that Auburn definitely has to do, which they have not done really in recent history, and you saw LSU do it, you saw Georgia do it in some points, and Alabama has been doing it for years once they, you know, started to open up their offense, is taking advantage of the mismatches in the intermediate passing game. If Auburn doesn't do that, then you're going to still see the sputtering in the offense. Because I even think this year, to help the offensive line, more quick strikes would have been great. More RPOs, more tempo would have been better. Because when you saw against certain games like Georgia, Minnesota, when they started to run tempo, that's where you saw the strength of this offense in place. So Bo Nix definitely has to raise his level of play and has to continue to be a student of the game and to learn how, say like Joe Burrow down at LSU, how to learn how to make those big plays count and how to really make the defense pay when they overrun or over pursue. Because if you over pursue Joe Burrow, he's going to kill you, because he knows his field range. He knows what's going on down the field. He sees down the field. And guess what? Somebody's going to be wide open. Look forward to seeing where Bo Nix will stand this year as Auburn's quarterback. I think he's going to be much improved. He has a year under his belt. Usually a quarterback from year one to year two I mean, the development is phenomenal. They say he does a great job of reviewing film. He doesn't make the same mistakes twice. And when you look at Bo Nix from last year, as far as protecting the football, there were only three games that he threw an interception. And for a true freshman quarterback with the level of competition that he was up against, I think that's pretty phenomenal. Once again, it's Kennard Vernon Stewart here for the podcast. We're talking Auburn football. Go ahead and like the video, comment, and subscribe. And as always, it's great to be an Auburn Tiger, War Eagle.